Merry Christmas. Yes, yes, it is still the Christmas season. The season of Christmas in the church year begins on December 25th and lasts for 12 days until the Festival of Epiphany, which is January 6th when we celebrate the coming of the wise men. So it is still the Christmas season. We can still say Merry Christmas and have our tree up and all those good things and sing the Christmas music that we love. I'm so happy to be back with you, and I'm thankful to Becky for filling in last Sunday so we could have some time with our family. A bunch of announcements are on your announcement sheet in your bulletin, but I am going to hit quite a few of them because there's lots coming up here. So our prayer vigil, which is in observance of the LCMC's 3 days of prayer to begin the new year, is happening tomorrow, actually. We had hoped we would fill every slot and have someone continuously praying from 3 o'clock until 7. Not all the spots are filled, so if you haven't signed up and you would like to do that, please take a time. If for some reason you cannot come and pray quietly and silently here at the church during that time, then you could take your time and pray it at home as well, if that would be easier for you. But we will be beginning the new year with a concentrated time of praying for our church, our families, our community, and our nation and our world. So you pray for whatever you want to pray in your time slot. That's entirely between you and God. If you are a committee chair or have some other responsibility, Danny would like to have your reports for the annual report to her by Tuesday, January 11th, so a little over a week from now. Also, if you are at all interested in renewing the local church, which is a series of online workshops taught by Pastor Brad Hale, who is a fun guy to listen to, that will be happening starting this week, actually. So if you are interested in that and you haven't signed up yet, please sign up and let me have your email address so I can send you the Zoom link for that. It'll be, I think, a very fun and interesting thing and beneficial to our church. If you can't make all the sessions, just attend the ones you can. That's fine. Also, I am starting a new Bible study, and it's just going to be a short one. 4 weeks is all it's going to be. On Sundays at 5 o'clock, starting next Sunday, and it is on the power of prayer. So we're going to be looking at what the Bible teaches us about prayer. And, of course, you're welcome to bring a friend or neighbor or anyone who would like to come. Also, poinsettia, we thank you. If you gave one, please take it home after worship today, and you can have some enjoyment yet at home with your poinsettia. I wanted to let you know that most of you have probably heard this through the prayer chain that Roland Post is in the hospital with COVID.
Doing
very well. So that's wonderful. We're so happy for that. And Carl said he thanks us all for the prayers. And Jana's also been in the hospital with COVID, but is doing well and hopes to be home in a day or two. So keep the prayers coming. Anybody have anything else as far as announcements go? That was a lot. I will also point out that if you haven't already, on the table by the front door are the new devotional books for the first 3 months of the year, as well as your January newsletter. So, okay. If there are no other announcements, we begin our worship with our time of confession and forgiveness. Please stand. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus Christ, the Savior of the nations, took on our human form in order to save humanity from sin, death, and the power of the devil. Let us take a few moments to examine our consciences, offering to our Lord a sincere confession of all our sins, known and unknown.
Most merciful God, we come before you this day with contrite hearts. Forgive us, we pray, for all the ways in which we have neglected our neighbors, turned from those in need, and trusted in our own will, rather than listening and obeying yours. Restore us to a right relationship with you, and give us a willingness to hear and follow your mandate to share the good news of great joy with all the world. For the grace of God has appeared in Jesus Christ, bringing salvation to all. Our great Savior and Lord gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify us for himself, a people of his own who are zealous to do good deeds. In him we put our trust as we receive his promise of forgiveness. Amen. Our opening hymn is Once in Royal David City. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Word who became flesh and dwelt among us, the love of the Father who created us in his own image, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, the giver of all good gifts, be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
for this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Let us pray. God of majesty, open our eyes to see the light of your presence in the world around us, revealed through the birth of your Son, Jesus, who took on our human existence. Sustain us through the Word made flesh, so that in these last days we might be your body in the world. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first lesson is from Isaiah 52. Verses 7 to 10. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of the messenger who announces peace, who brings good news, who announces salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your sentinels lift up their voices. Together they sing for joy, for in plain sight they see the return of the Lord to Zion. Break forth together into singing, you ruins of Jerusalem. For the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please read responsively with me from Psalm 2. Why do the nations conspire and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds asunder and cast their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord has them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with the rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore, O kings, be wise, be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear, with trembling. Kiss his feet, or he will be angry, and you will perish in the way, for his wrath is quickly kindled. Happy are all who take refuge in him. The second lesson is from Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 6. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a son, whom he anointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son, today I have begotten you? Or again, I will be his father, and he will be my son. And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says, let all God's angels worship him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become the children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me. From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. So, here we are, the day after New Year's, a little more than a week after Christmas, in the bleak midwinter. Once again, we're stuck with Alabama in the BCS championship. Most of the parties are over. Out in the world, no one is playing Christmas carols on the radio or in the stores anymore. Many people have taken their Christmas trees down and packed away all the decorations, thrown out the remaining leftovers, and vowed to stop eating all those rich foods so they can drop a few pounds in the new year. Some of the kids' new toys are already broken or discarded in a corner, and they are whining that they're bored or fighting over the remote. It's cold, it's dreary, and our patience, as well as our money, is running out. After all of the holiday hype, it can feel like a big letdown. Are you feeling that way? Does it seem suddenly that Christmas came and Christmas went in a blur of busyness and stress and exhaustion, and that somehow you missed it? Missed it, you might say. Missed it. How could we miss Christmas when it's been crammed down our throats since Halloween? Santa baby and All I Want for Christmas Is You on constant repeat in every store for weeks. Ads and commercials and promos all begging us to not forget to buy, buy, buy. Parties and fundraisers and get-togethers galore. Christmas specials and Hallmark movies and light shows. How could I have possibly missed Christmas? And yet, for all the ways the world has claimed to celebrate Christmas, for all the talk about peace and love and joy, for all the festive decor and frantic celebrations, there is often something missing. Or rather, someone missing. In the world, a world that has tried to take over Christmas for commercial profits or political gain or sentimental manipulation, Christ is often missing from Christmas. Jesus, the holy babe of Bethlehem, the reason for the season, is overlooked or forgotten or pushed aside. In other words, Jesus has come, and we missed him. Jesus has come, and we were too busy trying to buy the perfect gifts, bake the perfect cookies, create the perfect Hallmark family moments to notice. And so it has always been. Jesus came, born as a baby and laid in a water trough in a backwater village, and King Herod and all the religious folk of Jerusalem missed him. Jesus came, healing and teaching and offering forgiveness, and his own neighbors rejected him. Jesus came, giving his very life to save the lost, and nearly all of them, those who needed him the most, refused the gift. The author of the Gospel of John tells the Christmas story in a very different way than we are used to hearing from Matthew and Luke. There are no genealogies, no angels or shepherds or stars. Instead, John reveals the cosmic Jesus, the Jesus who was the Word of God made flesh, the beginning of all things, the human revelation of God's unknowable glory. The Christmas story that John tells is an even more amazing,
and wonderful and unbelievable story than anything that happened with the choirs of angels or wise men following a star. Because the story John tells is the story of the creator of the universe, the almighty and all-powerful God of the heavens, deliberately deciding to give it all up, to come down and take on flesh and blood and bone, to be helpless and needy. The maker of Mary, Mary's son, as the song says. It's the story of the very God who flung the planets into orbit and released the ocean's waves, submitting to having his diapers changed and his nose wiped. The God whom all people had been seeking for millennia, the God whom John tells us no one has ever seen, suddenly revealed himself, suddenly came down and lived right here among us. And nobody noticed. As John tells us, he was in the world, and the world came into being through him, and yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. So it has always been. So maybe you're regretting your holiday hangover right now. Maybe you're wishing you could take back those words spoken in anger at the family Christmas dinner, or return the excess of gifts that the grandkids didn't even seem to appreciate. Maybe you're sorry that you didn't spend less time watching the Hallmark Channel and more time kneeling at the manger. But you know what? Our God is a God of second chances. Our God is a God who forgives, who pursues, who never gives up. Our God works through the unlikeliest of circumstances, the most discouraging of conditions. As he did that holy night in Bethlehem, so he still does today. Even if you feel like you missed him, he is still here. Here in the church, where the Christmas tree is still up and the candles are still lit and we're still singing the carols. Here in the world, where he is present with each one of his beloved children, walking with you in the darkest times and places of despair and fear and helplessness. Here in the body and blood of Holy Communion, offering again his flesh and his blood for your forgiveness, to give you eternal life and salvation. In his gospel, John gives us the meat of the Christmas story, words of power and promise. The Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. If you've been looking for God in all the wrong places, you need look no further. God has found you. God has come down from his heavenly glory for you. God has kept his promise of salvation for you. God pours out grace upon grace for you. You didn't miss Christmas. It is yours forever through Jesus, the Word made flesh. Amen. Our hymn of the day is Sing We the Song of Emmanuel, and you'll find it up on the screen.
The song of Emmanuel, this the cry.
I invite you to stand and join with me in confessing our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, we come to you as people who suffer from too much food, too much to do, too many things. Lord, forgive us when we take those blessings for granted and when we put them in place of the only thing that really matters, which is worshiping and thanking and praising you for all you've done for us. Help us also to remember those who suffer not from too much, but from too little, those who are in poverty and want and despair. Let us share our blessings with those in need. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up those who are suffering because of storms and wildfires, particularly in Kentucky and Kansas and Colorado, but also in other places in the world that don't receive our attention as much. We ask that you would uphold and sustain them in this time, that they would feel your presence among them. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who at this time are feeling lonely or despairing or grieving. We pray that you would surround them with your comfort and care, and that you would keep our eyes and ears open to watch for those who may need an encouraging word or a helping hand. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for those who are ill at this time, who are in care facilities or hospitals or receiving treatments. We ask that you would surround them with your love and your healing
in every way, and we ask that you be with the medical personnel who care for them. We pray especially for Jillian, Amy Sue, Mike, Darlene, Sharon, Tana, Carol Joe, Bill, Shannon, Jana, Ken, Roland, Kyson, Marlis, Annette, Scott, and all others whom we name before you in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, gracious Heavenly Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abundant mercy. Through the name of our Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated as we give our offerings to the work of the Lord.
Thank you.
Holy God, we give you thanks for all that we have, ourselves, our time, and our treasures, all that first belonged to you and has been gifted to us, your children. Accept our offerings as a sign of our devotion to you and make us truly grateful for the many gifts we have received. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith, as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that you have fed us with Christ's precious body and blood, forgiven us through this sacrament, and given us a new beginning. Send us now into the world you love to share Christ's sacrificial love with all we meet. Amen. Great are the works of the Lord. Full of honor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. Go now in the name of the God Most High, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is Love Has Come, number 292. Go in peace. God's word has been fulfilled.